Good morning, and welcome to the First Baptist Church of Meridianville, Alabama. We are so very thankful that you've chosen to worship with us today, and we'll be starting our service in about 5 minutes. You'll see the countdown running, and then during that countdown, there will be some announcements related to our church. One important announcement is we are returning to in-house worship, tentatively planning on it. We understand that everything's tentative. But we are planning on returning to in-house worship on August the 16th. And so you may sign up for that worship, morning worship time on our church website. And so please be aware of that as you anticipate worshiping the Lord here at the First Baptist Church of Meridianville. We're just so very grateful that you've chosen to be with us today. We hope that this place, this church, is an oasis in a desert land where you find truth from God that allows you to flourish even in the midst of the challenges we face. God bless you, and thank you for being with us today.
Good morning, First Baptist family. I am pleased to be with you this morning. I always think of a guy named Charles Balcom. You know him. He's one of our church members. And most of the time on Sunday morning when I greet him, he says, "Top of the morning to you, Brother David." And I got to thinking, you know, I don't really know what top of the morning means. I assume that he is meaning good morning to you. So I went back and looked it up today. And it's an old English term, and it has to do with the homogenization process of milk. It's when the cream rises to the top. And when someone tells you top of the morning to you, they're telling you, may the cream of today bless you. May you have a good day because the cream rises to the top. So First Baptist family, top of the morning to you today, and may God's blessings be upon you. May the cream of the crop rise to you this morning. And I think one of the ways that God's cream will rise to the top for us this morning, God's blessings will rise up to us this morning, is by focusing on the truth of His Word. There's no better place that we can go to find out how God wants us to live than when it comes to going to His Word. So today our scripture passage is going to be from Colossians 4, chapter 2, or verse 4, chapter 4, verse 2 through 6 today. And as we read God's Word, if you can, stand up in honor of God's Word, because God is speaking His truth to you and I this morning. Paul tells us, "Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and being thankful, and pray for us too that God may open up a door to our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way that you conduct yourselves toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace and seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone in need." May God speak His truth to us today as we worship Him, as we seek Him, and as we honor Him by our obedience. Let's pray. Father, this morning we come to you knowing of our need for you. And Father, we need you. We need your word. We need your truth to be spoken into the deep, darkest recesses of our lives. And God, we need you to change us. We need you to transform who we are and how we live. So God, this morning, I thank you that you've given us this opportunity to worship together, to sing together, to read your word and to hear your word. And God, may you change us today. Whatever need we have, Father, may we find it met as we seek you and as we worship you. Father, once again, we will always be grateful for you rescuing us from our sins through the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray this prayer in His strong name, Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Good morning, church. It's good to be with you today. Let's worship together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place. you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of Glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is your name. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. You would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Good morning, church family. It's my privilege this morning to introduce us to a new memory verse for this month. And so this month we're going to be going through Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. And the reason why we've chosen this verse is because I think this verse, it is a verse that we all need to have memorized. It's something that we all need to be reminded of on a consistent basis. The verse talks about placing our trust in the Lord and pursuing after His ways and letting Him guide us through our day-to-day moments. To let Him guide us when things are good and when things are bad. And so it's a memory verse for this time, for the future, for every type of moment that we'll ever experience in our lives. So if you will, go ahead and read along with me Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, and so that we can try to memorize it together. Let's read. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. Church, let that be true of us this week, that we are a people that acknowledge our Lord in every moment, when it's good or when it's bad, when we're in highs of life or in the lows, when bad news comes, when good news comes, that we would place our trust in Him, that things would not sway us one way or another, but we would stay following after our Lord, that we would trust in Him and that He would guide us. Let me pray that over us, and let us together memorize this scripture and make it a part of our lives this next week. Let's pray. God, we thank You for this word that we need in our hearts. God, help us establish this word in our hearts. Help us be a people that acknowledge You in everything we do. Every big moment of life, every small moment of life, in everyday events, that we would acknowledge You as our Lord, that we would trust in You as our Lord. And Father, that through that, You would guide us. You would direct our paths. You would make it clear where we're supposed to go and what we're supposed to do. Father, help us walk in Your name. Help us be Your servants. Help us live in Your will. God, we ask that You would move upon our church. Help us be the people You've called us to be for Your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, church.
Good morning again, and welcome to our worship. Today, as we think about giving to the Lord, I think of a story that I heard years ago about a little boy. It was a simpler time when things were much less expensive, and he and his family were at a hotel, and his parents were in the lobby, and he wanted to go and get an ice cream sundae in the hotel restaurant. So his parents gave him some money, and he went and sat down at a table. It was a very busy time in the restaurant, as a matter of fact. And a waitress came up and said, what do you want? And it was fairly brusquely because she was busy, really didn't have a whole lot of time for a little boy. And he looked up at her and said, well, how much for an ice cream sundae? And she looked at him and said, 50 cents. And then he reached down into his pocket and started counting out his money and said, well, how much for just a cup of ice cream? And she said, 35 cents. And just giving the vibe that you need to get on with your order because I've got other tables to wait on. And she knew that she obviously wouldn't get a big tip from him. And so the little boy looked at his money again and said, well, I'll just take a cup of ice cream. And so she brought him his cup of ice cream, and when she came back after he had finished, there on the table were two nickels and five pennies, the 15 cents that he could have used to have the ice cream sundae, but he wanted to make sure that he had something left for her. She actually had a lump in her throat as she cleared that off that table. Well, when I think of that, I think of how he sacrificed so that she might have, so that he might leave her a tip. And I think in our lives, one of the reasons that we can continue to give to missions here at the First Baptist Church of Meridianville, one of the reasons we can continue to help families on Mondays and throughout the week, one of the reasons that we can continue to give to the cooperative program and help students in seminaries. One of the reasons that we can continue to minister the way we minister is because of your faithfulness to give to the kingdom of God, it's because of your sacrifices that we are able to do the things we do here at the First Baptist Church. So this morning, I want to thank you for your faithfulness. I want to encourage you and to just, I pray that God would return a double portion of blessing upon you for all the ways that you are supporting His work during these days. God bless you, and thank you for your faithfulness to give to His kingdom.
Grace greater than our sin. Let's sing together this morning.
Oh,
Good morning again, church family. I don't know if I've told you this. I can't remember if I have. But in case I haven't told you, I have some grandchildren. Yes, I got three of them, two boys and one girl. And they are such a blessing. This is a picture of us on the beach this past summer, and I just thoroughly enjoy them. One of the things that I love about my grandchildren, and I'm sure if you got grandchildren too, you love this. They are so honest, and I just like to sit back and listen to them. Listen to what they say and watch what they do. They do some amazing things. They do some profound things. They say some things that are really wise, and they don't even know it. This reminds me of a story of a grandmother and a grandfather. They had their grandson with them, and they were backing out of their driveway. And grandmother says, "Finally, we're on our way to vacation. We're finally on vacation." To which the grandson in the back seat said, "I'm not on vacation. I'm on mission." I don't know if he knew what his mission was, but he sure had it true. He wasn't on vacation, he was on mission. And sometimes I think that that we use the word mission, and we know that we're supposed to be on mission, but we don't really know what our mission is as God's followers, as Christians. Oh, what is our mission? Some of us think that God's mission for us is, I come to Christ. I place my faith and trust in Christ. That's my mission. Well, only partly. Some of us think and feel that our mission is, we come to church and we worship on Sunday morning. We sing songs. We listen to God's Word. That's what God's mission is for me. Only partly true. Others feel like, my mission is come to worship. Yeah, my mission is to come to Christ. But my mission really is to come back and grow as a disciple, get deep in God's Word, join this Bible study, join that Bible study, go to this small group, go to that small group, get more understanding of what the truth of God's Word says. That's my mission. Well, only partly true. For when we look at the Word of God, God's Word tells us that His mission for us is both inward. Yes, we grow in Christ. We study His Word. We become accustomed to what the truth of God's Word says. Yes, that's part of it. We grow inward, but at the same time, we are pushed outward. Our mission is both inward, becoming like Christ, and outward, giving out Christ, sharing Christ with our world. So Paul tells us in Colossians 3 that our mission is both an inward mission and it's an outward mission. And as we pursue our inward mission and our outward mission, we are sent on mission to a world that is broken and in need of a Savior. So let's look at what Paul says. First of all, he talks about our inward mission. And a lot of us think at times that our inward mission has to be fulfilled before we can go out and be on mission with God. In other words, I have to grow up in Christ and truly be spiritually mature before I'm sent outward. But that's not true. Jesus immediately sent His disciples, as He was working inward in their lives, He sent them outward. The early church, as Christ transformed them inwardly, He always and quickly sent them outward. So when we think of God's inward mission for us, Paul tells us in Colossians 4:2, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and being thankful. That's our inward mission. Our inward mission is both be a student of God's Word and pray. Be a student of God's Word and pray. And you say, well, Brother David, where do you see in Colossians 4:2 that it says anything about pursuing God through His Word, reading His Word, studying His Word? Where do you see that? Well, if you understand what prayer is, a lot of us think that prayer is just talking to God about what is on our heart. But as importantly, if not more importantly, prayer is God speaking to us. Yes, we tell God what's on our mind, what we need, what we think we need. But God always trumps us by speaking to us through His Word about us. We both speak to God in prayer, but we listen to God. And the primary way that God speaks to us about what's going on in our life is when we listen to His Word. So yes, when it comes to prayer, the Word of God must be central. Oh, we cannot divorce the Word of God from prayer because they're married together. As we talk about, to God about what's going on in our life, God talks to us about what we need. So when we think of prayer, always think of it that it's God speaking to us through His Word also. But when Paul tells us about prayer, Specifically, he says, devote yourselves in prayer. So the first aspect of prayer is that we devote ourselves to God. We devote ourselves to speaking to God about what's going on in our lives. The word devoted comes from a Greek word, and it means to adhere. It means to be sticky. It means to spend much time on. And it means to pursue with perseverance. Stick to it. Be steadfast in prayer, Paul says. Start with prayer and never give up praying. Start with pursuing God and never stop pursuing God. Start with listening to God through His Word and never stop listening to God through His Word. Start with talking to God about what's going on in your life and never stop talking to God about what's going on in your life. Start with praying to God for revival and spiritual awakening and for God to heal our land and for God to heal His people. Start with that and never stop praying for that. Start with specific people who do not know Christ. Start with naming them and praying for them and never stop praying for them until they come to know Jesus as their Savior. And I got to ask you this morning, as I ask myself, how devoted are you to prayer? How devoted are you to speaking to God about what's going on in your life? How devoted to you to prayer are you to God when it comes to praying for folks who need Jesus as their Savior? Quite honestly, if I don't get an answer really, really quick, sometimes my devotion to praying for that specific need goes by the wayside. So I have to ask myself, and I have to ask you, how devoted are you? How steadfast are you to continually praying for the needs of broken people and the needs of people who need Jesus as their Savior? As I was thinking about the word devoted, devotion, you can tell your devotion to someone or something by how much time you spend with that person or on that thing. And I don't know about you, but each week I get a weekly report on my iPhone that tells me how much time I have spent on my iPhone during any given week. And folks, it's hours. Sometimes it says you're down somewhat, but most of the time it's hours. And I had to ask myself, I wonder what would happen if I got a weekly report from the Holy Spirit that tells me my devotion to prayer, my devotion to praying for those who are broken, my devotion to praying for those who need Jesus as their Savior. Oh, what would the report say? How much time have I spent praying and seeking and begging for folks to come to know Jesus as their Savior? Francis Chan, who's a pastor, was over in Korea one time, and he was in a hotel room, spent the night in this hotel room before he began the day of doing what he was supposed to be doing that day. And he said about 4 o'clock in the morning, there became this bright glow in my hotel room. And I awakened, and it was coming from the window in my hotel room. So he said, I couldn't sleep anyway, so I got up and I went and I looked. Where's this bright light coming from? And it was coming from a stadium not too far from his hotel. He said, well, I'm up. I might as well go see what's going on in that stadium. They're probably practicing soccer. So I'll go over and I'll just see what's going on. I'll watch them practice. But when he got there, he didn't see soccer players. He didn't see soccer practice. And as he was walking into the stadium, he asked the guy, he said, "Oh, what's going on here?" He saw thousands of people on their knees. "Oh, what are these people doing?" And the guy said, "They're praying. They've been here since 5 o'clock, and they will pray till 7 o'clock before they have to go to work." And Francis Chan said, well, I suppose they're getting ready for a crusade or something, and they're here for a few days." And the guy said, "No, they're here every day. Every morning at 5 o'clock, from 7 o'clock to 7 o'clock. What are they doing? Well, they're praying for revival. They're praying for spiritual awakening. They're praying for their friends who do not know Jesus as their Savior. They're sticking to bringing their needs before the Heavenly Father." So as we think of our mission, let us never forget that we're to be devoted to prayer. We're being devoted to prayer on behalf of folks that we know who need Jesus as their Savior. But the second aspect of our inward mission, second aspect of prayer, Paul tells us, is that we are to be watchful in prayer. Pray and be watchful, Paul says. Watchful comes from a Greek word that means to guard. It means to be vigilant. It means to be alert. It means to continually gaze, and look with a purpose. The picture is a watchman on the watchtower at night, and he constantly watches. He's constantly vigilant. He's constantly gazing at the gate and the wall. Why? His job is to protect that fort from the enemy. So he's constantly watching and constantly gazing. And folks, when it comes to prayer, when it comes to our pursuit of God, Paul says that we're constantly to be watchful. We're constantly to guard our hearts against the enemy's attack. You see, Satan doesn't want us to pray. He doesn't want us to seek God and to listen to God from His Word. So what Satan wants to do is he wants to get our focus off of God, to get our focus off of prayer. He wants us he says it's all right for God to be a part of your life. It's all right for you to pray, but make that about your third or fourth or fifth priority in your life. And folks, if that's the case, you will never pray. If that's the case, you will never seek God through His Word. So what Paul is telling us, be watchful and guard that you seek God with all your heart, that He's the focus of your life. Be watchful that you're in His Word. Be watchful in prayer on behalf of your world and on behalf of folks who need to know Jesus Christ. Be watchful and continually pray for revival among God's people. Be watchful and guard against apathy in prayer. Be watchful and guard against those things that keep us from praying. The word watchful also means that we can be watchful for opportunities. Pray and watch for opportunities that we can pray for people specifically, that we can be used by God specifically to meet their needs. Be watchful in prayer. Never let prayer drop to third or fourth or fifth priority in your life. Guard against that. Keep Christ as Lord of your life and the center of your life, and keep prayer and talking to God and listening to God the very center of your heart. But Paul also says, as we are praying, we should be thankful in prayer. We should be thankful in prayer. Devote yourselves to praying, being watchful and being thankful. Thankful, again, comes from a Greek word, and it means to be grateful for God because He's always working out something and things for your good and for the good of this world. Jesus put it this way. He said, "My Father is always working, even to this day." Even the most distant person, even people who claim to be atheist and agnostic, guess what? God is always working in their life. He's already been working in their life. He's working right now, even though we may not see it. God is working on those folks that you're praying for. You may think they're so far away from God and Christ that they will never, ever give God a thought. But God is working through circumstances. God is working through people. God is working through you and me to draw them close to Himself. And we can be thankful that God is always working, and we can be thankful that God never gives up working, and He will continually work on behalf of folks who need to know Jesus as their Savior. So as we pray, let's be thankful that God is bigger than we are, that God is in control, and He is always working to bring folks to Him. That's our inward mission, to pray and to seek God, not only for what we need, not only for what the church needs, but we should be thankful that we have an opportunity not only to pray, but God allows us to jump in on the process of sharing Jesus with folks. So we have our inward mission, and we should never give up on praying for people. But as we think about our inward mission, remember that God not only continually is working in us, but He's continually pushing us outward. As He is transforming us, He is sending us out to use us as His heralds of the good news of Jesus Christ. So we have an inward mission, and we're pushed outward on mission with God. Paul says that our outward mission is something like this. Be wise in the way you conduct yourselves toward outsiders. Let your conversation always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. So the question is, as I am sent outward on mission with God, well, who am I responsible for? Who is my audience? Who am I to reach as I'm on mission with God? Well, Paul kind of puts it very plainly. He said, really, it's very simple. Everyone. Who's my audience? Everyone. Who are you and I responsible for? Everyone. You see, so often we get lost in our days. We get lost in our jobs. We get lost in what it is we're doing, and we fail to remember that our life's mission really is to invest in people. People are our mission. People in need of a Savior are our mission. Let's never lose sight of the fact that people have souls and people have a need for Jesus Christ. And the very best thing that we can do is understand our audience and give them Jesus. I like to put it this way. Everybody's got a Jesus puzzle in our soul. Everybody's got a Jesus puzzle in our soul. Some people have no pieces of the Jesus puzzle put together in their life, meaning they have never, ever heard the name Jesus. Who's responsible for them? We are. Other people have a few pieces of the Jesus puzzle put together, meaning they've had gospel conversations with somebody. They've heard the name Jesus, and they know kind of who Jesus is. Some of the pieces of the puzzle are already put together in their lives. Who's responsible for putting the other pieces of the puzzle together? We are. Some people that you and I come in contact with each day have most of their puzzle pieces put together of Jesus. Their understanding of Jesus, oh, they're so close to coming to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And you and I are responsible for putting those final pieces of the puzzle together for them. Yes, folks, we are experts in putting together puzzles, namely the Jesus puzzle. Everyone's our mission. But Paul kind of gets a little bit more specific on who's our audience, who's our mission. He says, conduct yourselves wisely toward outsiders. Another way of putting everyone is the word outsider. Paul says there's some people that are outside the understanding of faith in Jesus Christ. They don't know Jesus as their Savior. They're alienated from God because of their sin. And folks, we're responsible for helping them find the love of God through Jesus Christ. But the term outsider can also mean those who, yes, they're Christians, but they're outside the boundaries of the truth of God's Word. They're not living their life according to the truth of God's Word. Maybe they don't know it. And maybe God wants to use us to bring truth to their lives. They're outside the protective boundaries of the truth of God's Word, and they're feeling the pain. They're not feeling fellowship with God. They're not feeling like Jesus Christ makes any difference in their lives at all. And folks, they're our audience. Some of them sit in pews in churches every Sunday, and they still are not experiencing God in a way that they thought they would. Some of them you work with every day. They're in your neighborhoods. They're in your schools. They need Jesus, and they need somebody to speak the word of Jesus into their heart. So outsiders are our audience. Everyone without Christ is our audience, and we're responsible for giving them Jesus. Well, how do we do that? It's one thing to know that they're 7.5 billion people in this world, and a whole bunch of them don't know Jesus as their Savior. A whole bunch of them are living in our neighborhoods. A whole bunch of them we work every day with, and we rub noses every day in our neighborhoods with them. Well, how do we reach them? How do we live on mission for God? Well, Paul gives us really three simple ways. First of all, he says in Colossians 4:5, he says, conduct yourselves wisely toward outsiders, making the most of every opportunity. Making the most of every opportunity. That word, making the most, literally means to buy up. It's a marketplace term. And it means that you see a bargain and you buy it up quickly because that bargain won't be there for very long. Opportunities are like that. My son Ben just went to work for Alabama Power. And yes, he's got, you know, right now 10 days, 15 days of vacation. But he works for a company, and I think some of you probably do too. If you've used your vacation time up, they give you the ability to buy back some vacation. Buy some vacation. You have to spend your hard, cold cash to buy vacation time. And whereas you may have wasted 2 weeks of vacation just because it was part of your job package, but when it comes to spending your hard, cold cash on buying vacation time, guess what? You're more apt to use that vacation time wisely. You're not gonna sleep till noon and then eat a bowl of cereal over 3 hours worth of TV before you get going during the day, because you want to use that time wisely. And what Paul is telling us is that the days we have, yes, we live them, but we never give them back. We never get them back. We are to use our days as a series of days, a series of opportunities in the lives of people that we can leverage those days for the cause of Jesus Christ. We can speak truth into the lives of people because we have bought up that time, and we take our opportunities with folks very seriously, and we give them Jesus. We buy up those opportunities. Folks, these aren't just some days that we amble through. These are our only days. Folks, these are not just COVID days where we kind of try to survive and get through to a better day. No, these are days ordained by God and allowed by God for us to live on behalf of people who need to know Jesus Christ, for us to leverage the gospel and use the opportunities that we have to give them Jesus. Folks, these are the days. These days that we have today, they're our only days. And these are days where the church should rise up. Rise up and boldly give our neighbors, give folks we work with, give our families, give folks outside of Christ, give them Jesus. Use these days wisely. You see, these COVID days, they didn't catch God off guard. God didn't just wake up in the beginning of this year and say, "Oh, COVID. Didn't see that coming. COVID. Church, you pause for a while and let me get back to you because I got to figure this thing out." No. God knew this from eternity past. And He does not want His church shrinking and cowering. He wants His church to boldly stand up, use these opportunities, use these days to give people Jesus. Use these days not focusing inward, not self-protecting, though we do what we're supposed to do as far as what our government and the health officials tell us to do. Yes, do those things, but boldly reach your neighborhoods, boldly reach those folks without Jesus. Use those opportunities. Well, how do we use those opportunities? Paul tells us two ways. He says, be wise in the way you conduct yourselves toward outsiders. Conduct or conduct. It means how we live. It means how we walk. It means how we behave in front of a watching world. And folks, left to ourselves, we're going to behave just like the world does. But when we're wise, that means looking at life from God's perspective. That means looking at life through God's Word. And when we are students of God's Word, God begins to transform our inward behavior. He begins to transform our outward behavior in a way that makes people stand up and take note of the Jesus we serve. So we're to be wise in the way we behave. You know, our world is tired of hearing Christians say one thing and do another thing. Say we believe this and then live another way. Our world's tired of that. What our world longs for is someone to live Jesus in front of them. Someone to behave in a way that looks a little bit like Jesus makes a difference in their lives. Someone who doesn't act and do what the world does. Our world longs for someone to live like Jesus. When I was a senior in high school, I learned a pretty tough lesson. I worked at Winn-Dixie, which was a grocery store. And one day, a fellow employee came into my line to buy something. It was around Christmas time, toward the end of Christmas season, and most of our Christmas trees were already sold. They had a few Charlie Brown Christmas trees left over, but there wasn't much. And when we first started selling these trees, they were $10. It kind of dates myself. A $10 Christmas tree, that would be a bargain for the day. Well, this guy came through with a slip of paper, which you use to find out the price of the Christmas tree. And he had marked through $10 and put a 10-cent tag on that Christmas tree. Well, yours truly did something that was really out of character for me, but I succumbed to peer pressure. And I rang up 10 cents for a $10 Christmas tree. He went his way. I did my thing. At the end of the evening, my boss called me in. And he said, "David, did you sell a $10 Christmas tree for 10 cents?" And I ducked my head and I said, "Yes, sir, I did." He said, "You knew that though the Christmas tree prices were coming down, it wasn't for 10 cents, didn't you?" And I said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "Well, you're fired. You're fired." I left that evening in shame, in pain, in guilt. But the only thing I did right that night was talk to my parents and pray about it and confess that sin and repent from that sin. And you know, part of that repentance process for me was sucking it up and going back to my boss the next day and saying, "You know, what I did was wrong. What I did was out of character for me." And he said, "I know you're not going to give me my job back, but can I ask you to forgive me for what I did? What I did was wrong." And he looked at me and he said, "David, though I had never told him I was a Christian, though I had never done anything but to try to do my job," he said, "David, of all the employees in this store, teenagers on up to adults, he said, you're the last one that I ever thought would do something like this." Boy, he was looking for someone to live Jesus. And I did what everybody else did. We'd say he was a bigger man than I was. I told him, "You know, it would never happen again. And he said, I'm going to give you your job back. And basically he said, I want you to live what you believe to people in this store. So folks, our world needs people like you and me who know Jesus as our Savior. Our world needs us to live Jesus in front of them. Our world needs us to conduct ourselves in a way that looks like Jesus. But folks, our world not only needs us to model Jesus by our behavior, our world needs us to talk to them in a way that sounds like Jesus. Paul says, let your conversation always be full of grace and seasoned with salt. Talk with grace and add some salt. Speak in a way that catches your world off guard. Our world's hateful. Our world's coarse. Our world's unkind. Our world's unloving. And our world is unforgiving. And they speak those things to us all the time. And when folks speak unkind things to us, the natural response is to give it back to them. Give them hate. Give them anger. Give them bitterness. But what Paul is saying, when people talk to you like unsaved people do, talk to them with grace. Add some kind words. Add some words of I'm going to love you like Jesus. Add some words of forgiveness in your talk. Too often, whether it's vocally speaking face to face with people or on our social media, folks, too often we as Christians are talking to not only the world, but we're talking to our own kind in a way that's unkind and unloving and unforgiveness and unforgiving. God, forgive us, for we, as God's children, are to speak with grace and love and kindness. And by the way, add a little salt. Add a little salt in your conversation that leaves folks longing and thirsting for more of Jesus in their lives. So what's Paul saying here? He's saying, it matters how you live. It matters to your world how you talk. You see, folks, we are living, moving temples. God's Spirit lives inside of us. And wherever we are, folks have a chance to encounter God. How we behave, how we love people, how we're kind to people, how we serve people, gives our world, who desperately needs Jesus, it gives our world a chance to encounter the living God. And folks, how we talk, how we speak words of love, how we speak words of kindness, how we speak words of grace and mercy and forgiveness to one another, into our world, gives them a chance to hear God. Folks, yes, we are on mission. We're not on vacation. We're on mission. And our mission is that God would transform us into prayer warriors inwardly, and students of His Word, and that He would push us outward into our neighborhoods, into our workplaces, into our school places, into our world, where folks can see God, and folks can hear God. We're going to pray in just a moment. But when I finish praying, I want you to hear a song from David Ashley Trent. And the song is called Weary. And the gist of that song is, wherever you go, sow good seeds. Wherever you go, sow good seeds. And help people encounter God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. And God, your word is so personal. And your word really meets us where we are. It meets us in our deepest need. And God, we don't know what's ahead for us as far as this world goes, as far as COVID-19 goes. But God, may we live these days as though these are our only days. And these are the days that your church should shine for Jesus Christ. And God, do your inward work in us through your word and through prayer and through us listening to you. And God, continually push us outward into the lives of people who need Jesus. And God, may we see a transformation in our own lives. May we see revival in this church. May we see revival in your church. And God, may we see a spiritual awakening where large numbers of folks come to know Jesus as their Savior in the upcoming days. May we pray that. May we live that. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Bless us, David.
The fields are dry and the days are long, and your hand's on the plow but your strength is gone. There's a harvest coming if you just hold on. Never get tired of doing what's right. Never get tired of doing what's good. Never get tired of shining your light in the world like you know you should. Let us not grow weary, sowing good seeds everywhere we go. Weary, showing love to everyone we know. Just a little longer till the Savior returns. Let us not grow weary till the work is done. When the drought is gone and the seasons change, and your joy's restored with the pouring rain, fix your eyes on the Maker just the same. Never get tired of doing what's right. Never get tired of doing what's good. Never get tired of shining your light in the world like you know you should. Let us not grow weary, sowing good seeds everywhere we go. Weary, showing love to everyone we know. Just a little longer till the Savior returns. Let us not grow weary till the work is done. Keep on keeping on. Whenever you're weak, not grow weary. Sowing good seeds everywhere we go. We're showing love to everyone we know. Just a little longer till the Savior returns. Let us not grow weary till the work is done.